Now a closer look on the instrument, I will switch it on again and then you can see how it's booting up and how the fan is starting to blow and that it makes some noise. And one thing that you can see here, this instrument is from 2003, so quite old, but it still performs very well. And it's not booting any Windows in the background. There's some very, very basic firmware on this instrument. And so now it's started up. And usually the first thing that you would like to do if you do measurements with such a complicated device is you will use the preset button, which is typically very easy to find here. It's this green one, to put the instrument in a basic, in a default state, because you don't know what strange settings have been set before by some user. You want to start with initial settings, so you press preset and go to a basic state. And so now we will more or less go through all the buttons and calibrate the instrument and perform some measurement and see what it does. So at first we have two buttons, A and B. They are for the different scales, and as you can see here, A now measures the magnitude of the impedance with a certain kilo ohms per division. A division is the scale, like a block on the scale. And channel B measures the phase of the impedance, also with some degrees per division. Okay, so then we can continue with the measurement button, and here you can set the different measurements. So the basic measurement that you are doing now is magnitude of the impedance and phase, and you can also measure resistance and reactance, different impedances, different capacitances. We will leave it as with this basic setting, magnitude of the impedance and phase of the impedance. So if we go to format, we can change the format from linear to logarithmic. And we will do this for this channel A. So for channel A, we will set it to logarithmic so that the Y scale here is a log scale. But for channel B, we will leave it on a linear scale, because for the phase of the impedance, it makes more sense to have this on a linear axis. Okay, so A is logarithmic, B is linear. So then with the display button here, you can go to different display settings, split this diagram. We will just leave this in this basic setting that we have the same, the two curves for the magnitude and phase in the very same diagram. Okay, the next button we will need later on, scales this display. Here we can later on use auto scale to auto scale it. The next button, BW, is bandwidth and average. Here you can set a measurement bandwidth, and this is like a precision. So the one is the very basic setting that goes quite fast. So the sweep here is very fast, but it's not very precise. And we can later on set it to 5, which is very, very precise. But then you will see that it also takes more time to do this sweep. The next button is the calibration button. We will also use this in a moment to set the test fixture that we have and to compensate the effect of this test fixture. Then this was all related to the measurement. Now we can set the stimulus, the source, because what it will do, it will apply some voltage and push some current through the device, for example, this resistor here that we are going to measure. And we can set the parameters of the source here. So the first one is sweep. So it's sweeping through the frequencies from 40 Hertz to 110 megahertz. We can set the number of points, 201. This is perfectly okay. It's sweeping up, but what we will do is we will switch the type from a linear sweep to a logarithmic sweep. So now it's sweeping in logarithmic steps, from the 40 Hertz to the 110 megahertz. And logarithmic sweeps means we put more emphasis on the low frequencies, and then it will sweep faster through the higher frequencies. Okay, the next button sets the source. And sometimes you can see this red warning message here, caution the bridge. This is the bridge is unbalanced. And this is because the source voltage, the 500 millivolts, they don't sound too much, but it's already quite high. If there's nothing connected here, So we will set this to a lower voltage, something like, so we will set the level and go to 200 millivolts. So now we have 200 millivolts sweeping in the logarithmic sweep from 40 hertz up to 110 megahertz. And again, we can see the source voltage there. And the next button is trigger. So it's now set to do continuous measurements. And later on, we will set this to do a single measurement for each component that you would like to have. Next buttons, start and stop, just set the start and stop frequency or center frequency or the frequency span. A numpad, of course, to enter values. Then we have some markers that we will use later on. And here, one button that we need also later on is to save. And as you can see, it will save the results on a very nice and old floppy disk, no USB here. And yeah, you need another floppy drive to get the data from this disk onto a USB pen drive onto your computer. Okay, so now we will continue with calibration. So push the calibration button and set the adapter. The standard setting is that the instrument will use this 1 meter cable, if you remember, but we don't have this cable now, we just have this fixture here, and this counts as none. This is not really a fixture. So we will set it to none, return, and now we can compensate the effect of this fixture. And we can do, you can do three basic measurements. We will just do two. We will compensate, or we will measure a perfect open. Yeah, nothing is connected now. This is a perfect open circuit. So we will do open calibration. It's measuring and then it makes a beep if it's finished. And now the open compensation is switched on. And now we will do the same stuff for a short measurement. And for the short measurement, we have this small piece of metal here that is a very, very good, very perfect short circuit. Connect this. And then we can push the short button and do a measurement with the short standard. And again, it's performing this measurement and makes a beep. And now also the short validation is switched on. So now with this open and short validation, and I will put this metal piece here back into place. With this open and short fixture compensation, we can do very precise measurements of very small and also very large impedances. And now we will do some real measurement and connect this resistor here. I will at first connect it like this. So you can see the resistor connected on both sides. Don't make it too tight. It's not very robust. And now you can see it will do some measurements. And yeah, the yellow curve A is the impedance, the magnitude of the impedance, and the blue curve is the phase. And so now I will select A and go to this scale button and select some auto scale, but yeah, nothing will really happen because it's more or less just a line because it's a resistor. The resistor should not change its resistance too much over frequency. And we can also auto scale the B channel, which is the phase. And then we can see that the phase stays constant and then it increases later on. So now I will use a marker. No, I will at first go to this trigger and say stop with this continuous measurements, just do a single measurement. Do a single measurement, you can see now that it measures and it takes quite a time to sweep through the low frequencies, and then for the high frequencies it's much faster. And now we have a fixed curve, and now we can use this marker button here and see the values. So in the low frequencies here you can see the frequency, and here you can see the values. We have something around 160 ohm because it's a 160 ohm resistor. And the phase is pretty close to zero, so we have some milli degrees. A resistor should not have a phase in the impedance. But you can see if we get to higher frequencies, so if we get into the megahertz range, 2 megahertz, 3 megahertz, the phase increases, and at 110 megahertz we almost already have something like 8, 9, 10 degrees. Why does this happen? Because we are creating a loop, we are building up a loop with this resistor here, and that's why we will get some loop inductance. And so what I will do now is I will open it up and put it closer, try to decrease the area of this loop, connect the resistor like this. Now it's very, very close, very, very small loop area, and go to trigger again and repeat this measurement. Go to single. So now it's measuring again. At the low frequencies, nothing should change. Still measuring the same amplitude and phase, but you can see now at the high frequencies, the phase influence is gone because there is no loop anymore, so we cannot have any loop inductance, so we cannot have a phase angle rising or increasing, going to 90 degrees for perfect inductance. Yeah, and this is a very, very basic measurement. Now you could repeat similar measurements for a capacitor, for an inductor like this one. And maybe what we can do just to show the effect in this video is to do, because you can see that we still have some noise on this curve, that I will disconnect the resistor again and go to the calibration, go to bandwidth and average and change this bandwidth. Change it from 1 fast but not very precise to 5, which means it's quite slow, but it's much, much more precise. Now it's set to 5. And now we need to calibrate again. So we will just quickly go to calibration, do this fixture compensation, and do this open measurement again. So nothing is connected, do the open measurement. And now you can see that it takes much, 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 much more time to do this measurement with the open standard, especially at the low frequencies where the periodic time of the oscillation is quite long. And then if we go to higher frequencies, it goes faster and faster and faster because the periodic time of the oscillation is also shorter. And now if it's finished, I will do the short calibration again, press the short button and wait until this short standard is being measured again, which again takes quite a time at low frequencies, but if you go to higher and higher and higher frequencies, it goes faster and faster and faster and faster because the periodic time is getting smaller and smaller and smaller. And if it beeps, it's finished, which happened just right now. So I will remove this short calibration standard again, put it back in place and reconnect our resistor. And I will put it back in the way that we had at the beginning, with the quite large loop area, go to trigger and start another single measurement. And now you can see how it's starting to measure, and it takes quite a time again at the low frequencies to do this measurement, as said, because we have changed the bandwidth. Now it's using a smaller bandwidth. Smaller bandwidth means less noise, and less noise means higher precision, so we can somehow trade in measurement time against precision. And the good thing is, if we go to higher frequencies, it's sweeping faster and faster and faster. And now you can see that by investing this higher amount of measurement time, we can increase the precision of the measurement. That's why it's called the precision impedance analyzer. And you get a very, very, very stable, almost perfect curve that looks a little bit like this is the result of a simulation and not the result of the measurement. And now the last thing that I would like to show in this video is how to save the results. So now we have a very nice result and we can save it using the save button, and then we can save the data, we can save graphics, or we can save a touchstone file. Data means you can select binary or ASCII data. We will select ASCII. Now it's reading. On this, you can select a file name. It's not very convenient to select a file name here. I will just select the letter B. So the file should be called B, and then you can say done. And now it's saving. You can see it's saving the file B text to the disk. And I don't know if you can hear it, but you also hear the typical sound, the classic sound of a floppy disk drive. And if the light goes off, then it's finished. And by the same way, if we go to return, we can also select graphics. Again, maybe, I don't know, select the letter B and say done. And then it will save the, like a screenshot of the display of the instrument as a TIFF file to the disk. So you directly have a picture, you don't really have the data, but you can see all stuff that is displayed here on the display. And what's very convenient and useful, if you want to compare the measurements that you do here of the impedance with measurements that you do with some vector network analyzer, you sometimes maybe want to save the results as a touchstone file. Again, I will just select the letter B as a file name and say done. And then it will save it as a S1P file, because this is a one port measurement that we have done. And now it will save the results as a reflection coefficient or scattering parameter of the power waves reflected by this load here. So that's all. That's the basic operation of this instrument. And we will again switch perspectives, and I will shortly try to summarize.